So, welcome to my Still Not Superheroes talk. Maybe you remember that 4 years ago I gave a talk, Heroes Not Superheroes, and this is basically part two of the things the heroes would prefer not to tell you. So, this is a bring your own popcorn talk, so it's quite entertaining. However, the heroes will need their glasses, you know? This one. So let me start with something that needed several glasses while it still existed, and that is Connect OpenSUSE.org. So the intention when it was created was to have our own social network, but in the end it was mostly used for managing our members because, you know, there are others who are more familiar with doing social networks. So what was the problem with it? It was unmaintained for years. And to make things even worse, it was PHP code so old that it needed a SLE 11. So we somehow need to manage the members, sorry. And we had lots of mailing list discussions how to do that, including several ideas. But you know, people are better at discussing things than at getting things done. And so Connect was running and running because, you know, we need it. Until one day, someone finally pulled the plug. So on the positive side, we got rid of our last SLE 11 in the infrastructure, but we still needed a replacement, and we found one. So maybe it's not perfect, but we found a solution that does the job. It's very easy to maintain, and it even allows to change the member database layout whenever we need it. So what did we take? This one. So you all know PHP MyAdmin, so we have a simple database with the members, and it's low maintenance. So, and as a side note, sometimes you get actionable results by discussing things only with the involved people, so like membership officials and a few heroes. And now that we finally got rid of the Connect OpenSUSE.org fossil, let me continue with something new. Maybe you noticed that we had a Fedora hatch at the OpenSUSE conference today. We'll have another one tomorrow. So, and I'm a big fan of collaboration with other distributions, but as much as I like Fedora, there is a limit. For example, if they break our conference website, which happened in April, and it only displayed an internal server error. So the error log showed the undefined method gravatar URL for Neil class. And if you don't know Ruby, Neil is basically null. So what happened? We looked at a template file, and then we noticed if it's that file, then someone had made the Fedora hatch a highlighted event. And SASE find out that the template blindly expects a speaker to exist, and it uses its properties. But, well, it turned out the Fedora hatch only had a submitter, which is Neil, but it did not have a speaker, so the speaker was Neil. So please be careful and don't confuse these two. And I mean, the fix was quite easy, so just check to the template if there is a speaker before trying to display its name. So you might have noticed on the English wiki that we have a new header, so a new media wiki version. It took quite some time, but finally on Easter I did an update. So enopensuse.org is now on the latest media wiki version. That's the good thing. Now the funny things. So I did a test update. You know, we have the EN test wiki. And there the update script would have run for about 2 days if I wouldn't have canceled it. So this gives the some things take time a double meaning. And then I used a separate MySQL instance instead of our Galera cluster to do the update. And there the update script ran in 15 minutes. So, lesson learned, Galera provides high availability, but not really write speed. And I mean, I have to admit, update scripts are probably the worst you can do to your database. So the update of the other wikis caused funny errors. For example, this screenshot is the main page of the old EN OpenSUSE.org wiki, or at least the update script thinks so. So you see it's a random discussion page, actually. And for the translated wikis like the German one, the update script thinks that several pages are invalid and recommends to delete them. The problem with this is basically we'll lose the content. So that's not a real option and needs some more digging. So you all know Nuremberg and probably are glad to be here again. But in November 2020, there was a little power outage and Nuremberg went dark. So this also affected the SUSE data center and therefore lots of OpenSUSE services which were down. And when the power came back and all the servers and VM were booted up again, well, we had some fun. So the forum sent mails to the admins because they couldn't reach the database. And mails means one mail per request, or in other words, lots of mails. So, I mean, that's a nice load test for our mail servers, but why couldn't the forums reach the database? Well, it was down. So, didn't I just say that Galera provides high availability? Well, in theory, yes. So, it's a multi-master setup with MariaDB. But if all nodes get shut down, then Galera prefers not to start over starting with maybe older data than on the other nodes. So that's good to prevent data loss, but it also means it needs some manual recovery and might cause some hours of downtime while this is running. So to make things even more funny, we had practiced this. For example, when someone had the idea to update the kernel on all nodes at the same time and rebooted them at the same time. So in the end, high availability setups are nice, but only if they improve things. And maybe we should have a second look at if there is a solution that makes more sense. And still caused by the power outage, we got a report that Beans OpenSUSE.org did strange things. So you probably don't know it. It runs Matomo for web statistics, so it's just a background thing. And it turned out it was moved to a new VM some months before the power outage, and the old VM was stopped but not disabled. And after the power outage, it booted again automatically, and it still had a public IP configured and grabbed it, so the new VM couldn't get it. So after all that fun, you know, never waste a crisis. And one of the heroes just asked, when can we have the next power outage for testing purposes? Another thing I really like is if a SUSE admin asks me, how can I SSH to one of our virtual machines, in this case, the ProvoName server, which is running in the SUSE data center. So always funny, but why not? So I also couldn't SSH there, but it was still reachable with SALT, and therefore I used what I called the SALT backdoor. So I logged in on the SALT master and just executed the systemctl stop firewall the command over SALT, and that helped. So it was already clear it's a firewall issue. So what had happened? So you see there's an internal zone allowing several things, and the public zone that allows only DNS access. Makes sense, however, maybe it wasn't the best idea to assign the internal interface to the public zone. So even on the internal interface, we only had DNS access. And speaking about SALT, our SALT repo is public, so you can look what we do with our configuration management. And we are salting more and more services. For example, our mail servers are salted since some months, but there are still several manual managed services left. And so far, our salt report doesn't have any commit message containing the word oops, so using salt seems to be a good idea. But, you know, you can always break things. So there is one thing that is worse than services that are not salted, and that is fully salted services that get manually modified as a hotfix without syncing back these changes to salt. And I always give this thing a name, and this is a salt time bomb, because run a salt high state and the hotfixes are gone. So I mentioned code open source org. So what is it? It's a Git forge. And maybe you remember that Sasi and Neil announced the plans to set up it 2 years ago. So it uses the Pesha software. And besides the hero stuff and something like managing membership, so if you want to become a member, there is a ticket system for it on codeopensuse.org. Also, the tumbleweed package services Ambiarod to codeopensuse.org. So, but it wouldn't be in my talk if nobody would have broken it. So, in February, the HTTPS certificate had expired, and it turned out the certificate was created with Dehydrated, so nothing special so far. But nobody had enabled the Dehydrated timer, so it wasn't reviewed. And to make things even more funny, you know, for Dehydrated, there's the domains.txt config file that was empty, and the domains were listed in a file called saltdomains.txt, and of course that file is not salted, because it only has salt in the name, you know. So you also know that we switched to Mailman 3 about 2 years ago, and you may remember that Sasi had a IKF migration running during that talk 2 years ago. And maybe you remember all those buzzwords on the slides. So what does it mean in practice? So the IKF migration, of course, gave us new links. So Sasi created a few redirects, so not much, just about 3 million or so. And the file with the redirects is 330 megabytes large. And we also found some interesting things in the old archives. For example, there were some mails from the future, like from 2036 and even 2094. The problem, they didn't include lottery numbers. Damn. And we also had fun with some lines starting with from and the space, because, you know, the mbox format is not really standardized, and you can interpret that as the start of a new mail, or you do a more strict parsing and interpret it different. So, yeah, was also a bit funny. So we, in the end, we had to manually edit some of the mbox files. So you may remember from these old slides that part about easy moderation. Yeah, right. So for a while, we had our mailing list set up to moderate mails from non-subscribers, and that basically means the spam piled up. And you know, there's this nice web interface. And well, it takes about 20 seconds to delete a single mail, and now do that with 20,000 mails in the queue, and I mean, it's still easy, and nobody did a promise about the speed. But Per, our mailing list admin, never wastes a crisis, and he described it as very therapeutic. But in the end, he gave up and wrote a script. So, and in the meantime, the mailing list setup was changed so that for most mailing lists, non-subscribers are just rejected. And we also have some fun with Python 3.6 and Mailman, because Mailman expects something newer, so maybe we switch some machines to Tumbleweed. So maybe you heard about SPF, Sender Policy Framework. Or maybe it meant to say source of problems of frustration. So basically, it's a DNS entry that tells other mail servers which servers are allowed to send mails with that domain in the sender. And some weeks ago, we noticed that our mailing list mails got accidentally sent with an envelope sender of OpenSUSE.org instead of OpenSUSE.org. So the mailman config was fine, but our outgoing relay did rewrite it. And this broke the bounce management, so we fixed it so that no longer valid addresses got unsubscribed. But, well, after that, we found out that about 10% of the mails sent to Gmail were rejected because of SPF. And interestingly, only the mails sent over IPv6 were rejected. So, I mean, at least we now know that our bounce management works again, but that also caused unsubscription of 370 Gmail users. I mean, we told them and they have to resubscribe. So what had happened? Well, lists OpenSUSE.org has a separate SPF entry, and somehow we forgot to allow the IPv6 address in it. So let's see. You might have heard about MirrorCache, or maybe you heard before about MirrorBrain. So in the last years, we used MirrorBrain on download OpenSUSE.org to redirect you to a mirror. And some weeks ago, we switched to a mirror cache, which then redirects you to the actual mirror. The good thing of mirror cache is that it's a database-only solution, so it doesn't need all the files on disk. And we can deploy instances on various places in the world. So we already have one in Nuremberg, one in the USA. I think I heard plans about having another one in Brazil, so the download should be faster because you don't have all those round-trip times to download OpenSUSE.org in Germany anymore. But, I mean, MirrorCache is a bit boring for this talk because so far it only broke Tumbleweed CLI because that didn't expect that if it asks for the latest Tumbleweed snapshot number that it gets an HTTP redirect instead. So that was quite easy to fix on the mirror cache side, so not much harm done, but yeah. And I think I should close with a tradition. You know, we have counter OpenSUSE.org, which displays when you get the next lib release. And it's a tradition that it breaks with nearly every release. And you see what you see here is the whole change that was done, and that broke. So why? Well, Python said invalid token. So the reason for this is if you have a leading zero on numbers in Python, then they get interpreted as octal numbers. And you know octal number 8 doesn't exist, but 6 was valid before. So looks harmless, but breaks everything. I mean, the fix was easy, just drop the zero. And if you now thought, oh, I also could have done that, well, join us. We have enough services to maintain, so you can maintain one of the existing services, or maybe you'd want to start and maintain something new. And I can promise you we offer everything from archaeology on old servers to managing services in Salt, or maybe you migrate an old server to something Salt manages. So if you want to join, some basic admin knowledge would be useful, and everything else are the things you can learn from us. So you learn lots of things, including things you didn't want to know. And of course, you'll have lots of fun. So we have sort of an entrance exam. It wasn't planned as such, but turned out to be one, and that is setting up the VPN connection to reach our internal network. So in theory, it should be easy. Just follow the guide we give you. But in practice, people found several ways to break the VPN setup. So for example, it turned out that if you are in the SUSE office, then UDP connections tend to be problematic. So use TCP. And one of the more funny learnings was that the username is case sensitive. So if you don't use uppercase, like your account was created, then you also can't log in. And one new hero even cheated a bit and invited a seasoned hero for a barbecue. And by the way, can you also help me with the VPN setup? I mean, there's nothing wrong with if. And as you can see, it even helps to appear in my talk. So if all this didn't scare you, join us. And with that, I want to say thanks to all the heroes who keep our infrastructure running, to everybody who reports infrastructure issues to admin@opensuse.org, and special thanks to everybody who accidentally contributed to this talk. I won't tell the names, but you know who you are. So, and of course, thanks to you for listening. So, if you have questions, just ask. I don't see questions, so thank you again.